With over 2,000 temples and shrines, including 17 UNESCO World Heritage Sites, Kyoto, Japan's former imperial city, is one of the world's most significant cultural treasures, and we might add, one of Japan's most beautiful and romantic cities, which makes it the perfect place to begin our adventure to rediscover ancient Japan. I'm David Celdran, and this is Executive Class.
Autumn in Kyoto. No other season brings out the serene beauty of the ancient imperial capital better. For over a millennium, Kyoto was the official residence of the Japanese imperial court. It was here where Japanese culture flourished and established its distinct identity. So much so that even when the capital was moved to Tokyo in 1868, Kyoto has remained the spiritual heart of Japan, where much of its ancient Shinto and Buddhist traditions survive. Kyoto today is a modern urban center and the third largest population in Japan. The city also receives up to 40 million local and foreign tourists every year. And though urban development and mass tourism continue to chip away at Kyoto's traditional character, the city's temples and shrines have miraculously withstood the test of time. Kiyomizu-dera Temple, a UNESCO World Heritage Site, is one of Kyoto's most famous landmarks and popular Buddhist pilgrimage sites. Kiyomizu means pure water, and many swear the water from the mountain spring has therapeutic, even miraculous powers. The temple and its unique wooden veranda is also a favorite spot for sightseeing. This is one of the few vantage points in the city with a panoramic view of Kyoto. With over 2,000 temples and shrines in the city, you'll need to limit your visit to only the most important. If you have time to visit only one, we recommend another UNESCO World Heritage Site, and perhaps Japan's most recognizable temple of all, Ryōan-ji. You've probably come across this scene before. It's Ryōan-ji's rock garden, acknowledged as the finest expression of Zen Buddhism. The anonymous creator of the garden in the 15th century laid out 15 rocks in a way that only 14 are visible at any one time and from any angle. In Buddhism, the number 15 represents completeness, and monks would be told to sit for hours, even days in front of the garden, until the hidden rock revealed itself. This was a crucial step in achieving enlightenment.
No one really knows for sure what this scenery means or who made it, but most people say it's about islands of happiness in a sea of uncertainty. If you sit still and empty your mind, you might come across a meaning of your own. Well, with all the tourists around, it's becoming hard to do that.
The veranda can get crowded, so it's best to avoid the peak hours of the day. But if you camp, the adjacent moss gardens are less crowded, and their beauty is equally inspiring. Too bad few realize that Ryōan-ji is much more than its famous rock garden. The huge temple grounds with its mirror pond and hidden pathways are just as uplifting. And in crowded Kyoto, it's probably the closest a foreigner gets to achieving enlightenment. Indeed, to outsiders or Gaijin, ancient Kyoto is often inaccessible. None more so than one of its most revered traditions, the tea ceremony.
One of the ancient arts that's slowly disappearing from Japan is the traditional tea ceremony, which originated here in Kyoto. It was performed to welcome important guests into the household. We're at the residence of a tea master in the south of Kyoto to show us how it's done the traditional way.
Jukeian in the eastern hills of Higashiyama is one of the few tea houses that accepts foreigners. In touristy Kyoto, the tea ceremony is one of the few traditions that remain untouched by commercialism. And this is why the rules that govern it haven't changed much since it was perfected in the 17th century. Tea houses are considered sacred ground, so no shoes are allowed inside. While the sensei or tea master prepares for the ceremony, guests approach a tea house from the pathway that symbolizes the journey from the outside world to the pure one inside.
This is where you wait while the sensei is preparing tea. Any moment now, she'll be calling me in.
The wait is also symbolic. The time is used to admire the tea garden, the better to rid oneself of all worldly thoughts before entering the spiritual realm. Unthinkable before, tea masters now include women, though their training is equally rigorous as men. Before inviting guests in, Soko Matsumoto washes herself, another symbol to represent purifying oneself before the ceremony begins.
Finally, we're ready to enter the tea house. But first, we must purify ourselves with some water.
Guests are also required to wash their mouths and hands, the two points of contact with a tea bowl.
During the tea ceremony, you're supposed to kneel on the tatami mat. But because I'm a foreigner, they gave me a small chair.
Another round of waiting takes place. Again, the better to empty one's mind and admire the austere beauty of the interiors. Guests are also encouraged to keep silent throughout. This keeps you focused on the essence of the ceremony. There's poetry and meaning every slow step of the way. Every touch and every movement follows a strict set of rules. No wonder the entire ceremony can take anywhere from 1 hour to 4 hours. Even receiving and drinking from the bowl is governed by tradition.
Finish everything.
Please.
A ceremony can involve as much as 4 guests, but each one ends the same way, with more ritual purification. Polite greeting before parting ways.
Arigatou gozaimasu.
Many of Kyoto's ancient traditions are losing their appeal among younger and more practical generations. But in the spiritual heart of Japan, institutions like these are still revered by most. When we return, we take you inside another part of Kyoto that is disappearing and see how locals are coming together to reclaim a proud part of their past. That's up next on Executive Class. Kyoto's most important landmarks have withstood civil war and natural disasters. But the city's once common Kyomachi houses have had less success surviving urban development. The long and narrow wooden Kyomachi townhouses are unique to Kyoto. Many go way back to the 17th century, when merchants and artisans servicing the imperial court traded up front and lived at the back. Fusei Kojima of the Kyomachiya Council, a non-profit working to preserve Kyoto's architectural gems, tells us that only about 47,000 of these remain. Every year, about 500 more are demolished to make way for taller cement buildings. These old and wood houses are expensive to restore and are proven fire hazards, and for many, a grim reminder of poorer days. Since 1936, the government has banned the construction of new Kyomachiya. Kojima-san takes us to see her home. She says despite the high cost of maintenance, and the threat of fire, she's managed to keep her place faithful to the original her grandfather bought 112 years ago. The 800 square meter structure is one of the best examples of traditional Kyomachiya architecture. Because taxes were based on the width of the property, homes were built long and narrow. Despite their age, Kyomachiya are comfortable and practical. Tatami mats keep the floor warm in winter and cool in summer. And instead of walls, sliding doors or screens can be opened, closed, or removed to alter the number, the size, or shape of rooms. Most foreigners never make it beyond the shop front of a Kyomachiya. The deeper one is allowed inside, the more intimate your relationship with the host. Consider it an honor if you make it this far. The Zajiki, where the best views of the garden are visible, is a space reserved for only the most special guests. Efforts to save the Kyomachiya are more than just about preserving a distinct architectural style. They also help conserve a traditional way of life and doing business. The confectionery Daikokuden has been selling traditional Japanese delicacies to Kyoto's elite for over a century. These delicate and expensive handcrafted sweets are made from recipes and designs handed down through generations. Sweets or wagashi are made with traditional ingredients like beans, rice, and flour. Their colors and designs reflect the season of the year. The owner, Mrs. Shibata, shows me some of the most precious items in her shop.
Mrs. Shibata, they look too beautiful to eat. Do people actually eat this?
Mazu, mede tabete itadaite, kuchi de tabete itadakimasu.
Japanese sweets are not just to eat. These are the ones that you enjoy watching or looking, the shape and the color, and then it doesn't have any, you know, so much taste in it. It's just sweet. But you also enjoy the shape and the meanings of the cakes.
In Kyoto, special sweets like these are used in the traditional tea ceremony or as special gifts. Shibata-san admits cheap mass-produced sweets are threatening the old tradition. But thanks to loyal customers who insist on the quality of her handcrafted creations, Daikokuden is one of the city's best-loved institutions. The parts of the city where the Kyomachiya still stand are where most of Kyoto's oldest traditions survive, including the most secretive ones.
The streets of the Gion district were once a center of Kyoto's plush requirements during the heyday of the geisha. Very few exist today, but you might be lucky enough to catch a glimpse of some maiko in the area.
The first geisha were from Kyoto, but from the tens of thousands of previous centuries, their population and that of her apprentice, the maiko, have dropped to under 100 in Kyoto. Your best chance for sighting one is in the shadows of Gion. And even if unsuccessful, the chance to walk the legendary streets of the pleasure quarters is still a thrill. Up next, we go deep into rural Kyoto for a taste of authentic country living. Our side trip across the mountains of Kyoto into a world it'll change by time when executive class returns. Many of Kyoto's ancient traditions have withstood the test of time, but the old cityscape has had less success surviving the crush of development. Urban Kyoto can be like most Japanese cities, congested and cemented. But beyond the mountains to the north, another side of Kyoto exists. Here in the countryside, past the maple and cedar forests, is a place where traditional Kyoto persists. This is Miyama, a small town in Kyoto Prefecture, where some of the last remaining thatch houses of Japan remain. It's off the tourist trail, but familiar with cultural travelers that come to catch a rare glimpse of traditional rural life. Chinsenro is a ryokan or country inn that has been hosting travelers for over 110 years. Chinsenro stands for Pillow River Ryokan. It was named after the sound of the river guests hear under their pillows at night. Like most ryokans, Chinsenro is family-owned. The Naganos have been running the inn for three generations and continue to offer the personalized service country inns are popular for. Travelers choose ryokans for the traditional hospitality and the rustic setting they offer. Rooms are in typical Japanese style, tatami mats in the day, and futons for sleeping at night. Natural spring baths or onsen are communal. But it's always for the home-cooked meals guests come all the way for.
One of the attractions of staying at a traditional family-run ryokan is the food that they serve, usually kaiseki style. The Naganos insist on using only original family recipes and locally sourced ingredients that are always in season.
The dinner kaiseki at Chinsenro is an elaborate meal of 15 dishes served in succession. Among the dishes are deer terrine, fried asu fish, nameko mushrooms, and kyojidori, a local chicken. All these come from nearby rivers, farms, and forests. It takes many hours for Mr. Nagano, a former cook from Osaka, and his daughter, a French-trained pastry chef, to prepare the dishes in their kitchen. Plating also takes time. The design and the way the food is displayed are made to reflect the seasons and shapes of nature.
It's called farm to plate. Everything on this spread is locally sourced, and that's why it's so fresh.
It's a feast for the taste buds and for the eyes. In the countryside, there's no rush to eat, and guests are encouraged to take their time to admire the beautifully arranged and garnished dishes. It's the same spirit behind the slow food movement in vogue today, except that Kyoto's kaiseki tradition goes back to the 16th century. Chinsenro is a short walk away from Miyama's main attraction, the Japanese cultural heritage site of Miyamakita.
The tiny farming village of Miyamakita is one of the last places in Japan where you'll still find the traditional Kitayama-style farmhouse architecture, known for its distinct thatch roofs. At one point, there were more than 7,000 of these houses in the Miyama area alone. Only 200 of these remain today, and only 38 in this village. That's what brings so many visitors here.
Much of Japanese architecture as we know it is borrowed from China, but these thatched farmhouses are considered indigenous to the country, and therefore a national treasure. However quaint it seems today, less and less rural folk find these 150-year-old houses practical. Thatch roofs don't last very long, and they leak over time. Sourcing the thatch is also difficult, and maintaining the thatch roofs requires skills no longer easy to find. Despite the inconvenience of living in one, locals are serious about preserving their way of life. The Folklore Museum raises funds and awareness about life in a traditional farmhouse. Aiko Nakano, the museum guide, tours me around a 200-year-old house restored to what original farmhouses in the Edo period were like. You get a sense of how farming families lived before the modern age changed the Japanese lifestyle forever. In the attic, you see why some families refuse to give up on thatch. Like our own nipa huts, thatch is a natural ventilating material. It keeps the whole house cool in the warm months. The downside is, thatch is a fire hazard, and flames can spread quickly from house to house. Locals have devised an ingenious system to put out any fire that could burn down their heritage. And it's what brings curious visitors from all over Japan to this small village twice a year.
Oh, it's starting to go up. Oh, everywhere.
The biannual fire drill is a sight to behold. Visitors surround the village to catch all 62 water guns, sprinkle every home, shrine, and temple. In case of fire, the water guns are triggered simultaneously by a fire alarm and run non-stop until fire trucks arrive. The dancing fountains have become as popular as the houses and have helped raise awareness about preserving another one of Kyoto's historical institutions. In Kyoto, like anywhere else in Japan, there's no stopping the rush to modernize. But it's the many traditions of the city that help keep it rooted in its past. Kyoto reminds us that we can change without having to abandon who we are essentially.
And that's all for this episode of Executive Class. From Miyama, Kyoto, I'm David Celdran. Sayonara, and thanks for watching.